Everyone. So we'll continue studying chapter 7, Knowledge of the Absolute Truth. Om Ajnanatim Randhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupaka Dhamahyam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurum Vaishnavamscha Sri Rupam Sagra Jatam Sagana Raghunatham Tam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Chaitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padam Sagana Vadita Sri Vishakhanvitam Scha He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dina Bandho Jagatpade Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Haripriye Vancha Kalpata Rubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasadi Gaura Bhaktavanda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare Mukham Karoti Vachalam Pangam Langayate Girim Yatripat Tam Aham Vande Shri Gurum Devatarinam. Hare Krishna everyone. We'll continue chapter 7. So we were covered up to verse number 11, the last to last sessions. So in this chapter, we learn more about Krishna, because in sixth chapter we learned Yoginam api sarvesham madgateir antaratmana. The best of the yogi always tries to meditate on the Supreme Lord Krishna. Yoginam api sarvesham madgateir antaratmana. Shraddhavan bhajate yama tamayamukta samayamukta tamoyataha. So that was the verse. So the greatest yogi is one who meditates always on the Supreme Lord. To meditate on the Supreme Lord, we need to know the personality of God. So this is a chapter that describes the personality of God. What are his characteristics? So far we covered 12 verses. Primarily, Krishna informed that he is the source of everything. So I'll now declare unto you this full knowledge, both phenomena and newness. This being known, nothing further shall remain. But this being known, the highest knowledge. That's what Krishna mentioned. Yeah, out of many thousands among men, one may endeavor for perfection, and out of those who have achieved perfection, hardly one knows me in truth. Now Krishna explains how everything comes from earth, water, fire, air, ether, mind, intelligence, and false ego. These are gross elements. Earth, water, fire, air, ether. Mind, intelligence, and false ego is the subtle elements. Altogether, these eight constitute my separated energies, material energies. Okay. So these are his material energies. And then he talks about his spiritual energies. Besides this, for Maitreya and Arjuna, there is another superior energy of mind which comprises the living entities. So we are also the living entities. We are also the energy of the Lord. So there is Prakriti and there is Purusha. Prakriti is the nature, the energy of the Lord, and Purusha. Purusha is the source of all the energy. Just like sun and sun's energies exist. Similarly, there is Supreme Lord. He has material energies, eight material energies, five gross and three subtle elements. And then he says, these are besides these gross and subtle material elements, there is superior spiritual energy, which is also part of him, which is also energy of him, which is his energy. And what are they doing? They comprise the living entities who are exploiting the resources of this material inferior energy. what are they doing? They are actually exploiting these five, these eight elements. So that is what they are doing. Yeah, and then he says, all created beings have their source in these natures. Everything that exists has source in these natures, which is, we belong to the spiritual energy of Lord, and there is material elements, right? Of all the material and all that is spiritual in this world, know for certain that I am the both the origin and dissolution. Krishna clearly says, Aham Krishnasya Jagataha Prabhava Pralayastata. I am the origin, I am the dissolution. Everything comes from me and everything dissolves me. So that's where we describe about the Mahavishnu form, which is an expansion of Lord. So in, that's meant specifically for material creation. So he is the origin and the dissolution. And then he says, Matta Parataram Nanyat, Kanchidashti Dhananjaya. Mai sarva idam protam sutre manigana eva. So this clearly, this is a very important sloka to understand the position of Lord Krishna. What does he say? Mattaha parataram na. There is no truth superior to me. Mattaha parataram na anyat means there is no other superior. Kinchidashti dhananjaya. My sarvam idam pratam sutre manigava. Everything rests upon me as pearls are strung on a thread. This clearly distinguishes and establishes the superiority of the Supreme Lord. Yeah, and then he describes how we can understand Lord, right? In every moment. For example, he says, I am the taste of water, the light of the sun and the moon, the syllable om in the Vedic mantras. I am the sound in ether and the ability in man. Ability in man means we have some abilities. Everybody, not man, just man or woman or animals. The ability in us is given by Lord. Because Lord is the owner of us, like he's the, we are the, you know, prakriti of the Supreme Lord. The abilities that are given to us are rightfully used in the service of Lord. Just like a servant in the hotel is meant to use all his energies in the service of the Lord, in the service of the hotel owner. Similarly, the abilities, if something is given to us, it is meant to be used in the service of the Lord. Punya gandha prithivyam cha tejas chasmi vibhavasu jivanam sarvabhuteshu tapas chasmi tapasyasu. I am the original fragrance of earth. All the fragrances come from earth. Right? Whatever plants that generate nice fragrance like Malliga, all these are deriving their flower and fragrance from earth. So earth is considered the source of all fragrances. God, Krishna says, I am that original fragrance. And I am the heat in fire. The essence of everything, basically. I am the life of all the lives, of all that lives. And I am the penances of all ascetics. The essence of every thing is Lord Krishna. Bijam mam sarvabhutara. Know that I am the original seed of all existence. Right? Like we described in the form of Mahavishnu, he is the original seed of all the material existence. At the Mahavishnu level and also within the universe, again there is Garbhodak Sai Vishnu, who is lying within the Garbha ocean, from whose navel comes the the transcendental lotus onto which Brahma is placed. So even that Mahavishnu is the source, is like the seed of this universe. So in this way, Lord is the universe. Lord is the seed of existence. The intelligence of the intelligent and the prowess of all powerful man. If you see an intelligent person, don't praise the intelligence of that individual. Understand that the source of that intelligence is God or Krishna. And the prowess of all powerful man. Any powerful man you see, the prowess is temporarily given to him, right? We have seen many, many great people in the past. Where are they? We don't see them anymore. temporarily somebody is given power and taken away again. Right? Somebody is rich today, temporarily poor. Wow, who will remember him after 50 years? Nobody will think about him, right? What happened to Rockefeller? He was the, or the Ford, Henry Ford, right? They were the greatest people about 50, 60 years back, the most powerful men in the world. But nobody even talks about them. Temporarily given, taken away. So in this way, right? But now what is the greatness in praising the individual? It is the prowess given by Lord and taken away time to time. So in this way, focus on the essence, right? When you see the intelligent person, wonder, you know, when you talk about Einstein being great, you know, the most intelligent person in the, you know, in the century, understand that the intelligence was given, endowed to him by Lord, right? Understand that. And appreciate the, you know, by seeing the intelligence of these people, we can understand the greatness of God. How intelligent beings can he create? Yeah. I am the strength of the strong, devoid of passion and desire. I am the sex life, which is not contrary to religious principles, O Lord of Bhavaka. Dharma viriddha bhuteshu kamosmi bharata shava. Sex life is the center, is the reason for procreation, right? And that is an important function. But when it is done with as a service to God, it is perfect. When it is violated, it is not. That's what is mentioned in this. Let's read this verse. Ichaiva sattvika bhava rajas rajasas tamasas chaye matta eveti tan vidhi napaham teshu te mayi. Please read, anyone? Rachna Mataji.
Yes, Prabhuji. Know that all states of being, be they of goodness, passion, or ignorance, are manifested by my energy. I am, in one sense, everything, but I am independent. I am not under the modes of material nature, for they, on the contrary, are within me.
So there are three modes. We discussed this. Three modes in the material nature, right? At a subtle level is, we are going to discuss this in detail in various chapters in the future, the modes. It's a very important concept to understand that these modes exist and they control our actions. Mode of goodness, sattva-guna. Mode of passion, rajoguna. Mode of ignorance, tamoguna. And these modes are prominent, for example, in the early morning hours, right? Brahma Muhurta time, like 4 a.m. to 7:30 a.m., 6 a.m. especially, is called Brahma Muhurta. It's the period of mode of sattva-guna or mode of goodness. And so there, that is the best time, for example, for practicing spiritual life. For example, I chant every day morning from morning 4 to 6. Right? That's when 6 to 6:30 I chant. So that is the best time. Whatever you chant at the time will benefit you 1,000 times. Because there is so much clarity, there is so much focus. That's the, you know, that's going to give you the best results. And mind is not distracted by your work or, you know, duties of the day, nothing. Mode of passion, for example, as time ticks by 8 a.m., what happens? The senses become active. You start thinking about cooking, thinking about office work, or planning for the day, buying, or so many things, get activated. The day becomes active. You become very passionate. You're completely engrossed in things of this world, right? In the dealings of this world. That goes on from somewhere around 8 to 9 to up to 5:36. So this is time where we are primarily in the mode of passion. And as evening sets in, you will be tired, right? And so mode of ignorance kicks in. So that is, from evening till, morning 3 o'clock, where primarily ignorance means you're not, your intelligence is not fully active. You're tired. You're ready to rest. It's not the best time to practice spiritual life. It's time to relax. So that is, the day. Everything is divided like that. There are foods in the mode of goodness, right? Krishna describes food like, juicy fruit, juicy, which are, easy to digest, which give pleasure to the heart, sweet in nature. They're all foods in the mode of goodness. The foods in the passion are very, somewhat very chilly taste, a little bit sour. So these kind of tastes, which are, a lot of masala and all, those are foods in the mode of passion. And ignorance is, wine, these things are all mode of ignorance. So based on what you like, what kind of time frame you like, what kind of foods you eat, that determines your kind of nature also, because you align with your nature in everything you do or everything. So every activity can also be divided into mode of goodness, passion, and ignorance. If you are always fruity mentality, always running behind, fruits of your work, passionate, so that is mode of passion. Mode of goodness means you work, but you don't bother about results so much. You always focused on the work. That is mode of goodness. And mode of ignorance is you don't have a plan, you don't work properly. So in this way, everything is divided into mode of goodness, passion, because there's influences. Those energies are your karmic frame of mind. Your sanchit karma is a composition of your these modes. And again, every individual has various modes actively. For example, in the morning, you might be primarily in the mode of goodness. In the afternoon, you are primarily in the mode of passion. In various situations also, our mode of goodness is, and passion and ignorance are of various percentage mixes. In certain situations, you may react in a much milder way, much thoughtful way. That is mode of goodness. So our goal as a spiritual practitioner is to turn our life events, foods we eat, everything into mode of goodness. As you do that, your spiritual quotient goes higher and higher. You will understand the spiritual matters easily, and you'll make spiritual progress, a lot of spiritual progress, by trying to limit yourself to the sphere of mode of goodness as much as possible. Right? So now, so these are three modes that only exist in the material realm. These don't exist in the spiritual realm, right? So a person who is self-realized is not under the influence of these modes. He's above and beyond these modes. When we see a thing, for example, everybody reacts differently. Why? Because their modes are different. So in the scriptures, there was an example of Ajamila. Have you heard about the story of Ajamila? Anybody?
Yes, Prabhuji.
You heard, right? Yeah. So Azamila was a Brahmana by birth. You know, he was taught Vedic scriptures, Vedic karmas. He was performing, leading a very religious life. He was married, he had children. So one day he went out to fetch firewood, and on the way back he sees this, you know, like some, you know, low class woman and man having public loving affairs. And so this happened in the past, in the Vedic times. It's a real story. So he was immediately influenced by the modes, right? So his past karma just, so as soon as you see something, your karma triggers. Your modes will influence you. You react differently based on who you are, right? So that's why as a spiritual practitioner, we try to avoid the impetuses or, you know, the try to give lesson, you know, try to avoid wrong stimuli that would drag our consciousness lower and lower into modes of passion and ignorance. We try to keep our consciousness in the mode of goodness. Okay? So, yeah. So, this person, he was, you know, doing everything fine, but he got influenced. Now, he didn't stop there. He goes to you know, his he goes to his in his home, and then thinks about how to enjoy this lady, and then finally tries to give up his own, you know, very chaste wife, and finally goes after this woman and completely spoils his life for the rest of his life. On the other hand, we hear the story of Narada Muni. Once upon a time, this is the story of Narada Muni passing by a lake. He sees some devas by the name Nalakuvera and Manigriva. They were taking bath, drinking wine. They're all devas. They are, like, you know, from higher planets, Swargaloka. They came to lower planets, to our planet, that is allowed in the higher planets, because that is a place of enjoyment. Just like a five-star hotel, people are allowed to drink, but not on the, you know, regular hotels, for example, right? So on the lower planets, those are considered sinful activities. So he comes and he, those guys were enjoying with their, you know, with their girlfriends, and everybody was naked. And Narada Muni passes by, he sees them, he takes pity on them, because these people were misusing their human life, or, you know, the birth in a higher responsible position as devas. They're trying to enjoy their senses. And on top of it, they saw Narada Muni, they didn't care for it. That is a bigger offense. And they went about their playful games. So Narada Muni curses them to become the trees in Vrindavan, where later on Lord Krishna would liberate them, right? So in this case, we see that Narada Muni, even though he was a passerby, he saw this scene, he was in the least influenced. Instead, he taught them a lesson. So that is the way advanced souls see. The lesson, even though it appears to be a curse in the short term, these people actually are getting closer to God in this through this action. Because they will be now born, they will be, you know, born as trees in Vrindavan, and at the appearance of Lord Krishna would deliver those two trees, yeah, Nalakuvera and Manigriva. So in this way, Narada Muni, you can see, he saw the same kind of scene, like Ajamila had seen, but in fact, this is like, you know, low class scene, right? What Ajamila had seen was a low class scene. What Narada Muni had witnessed is a much high class scene. These are devas and devakanyas. But he was in the least influenced, and instead he actually gave them, in a way, a benediction to be liberated in the next life. So in this way, everybody sees according to how the modes are influencing them. And this is what we should be careful about. When we live life in this world, always we can be influenced by the various modes. So always keep the holy name on your tongue. That way the influence of the modes is least. As soon as you chant the holy name, the influence reduces. Okay? I am in one sense everything, but I am independent. Krishna is everything. Everything comes from him. But he's also independent. Right? He's not influenced. This is all coming from him. So this cannot influence him, the modes. I'm not under the modes of nature, for they are, on the contrary, are within me. They come from Lord. And they are the energies of the Lord. They are created so that people in the material world will try to enjoy in the way they want, right? According to their perverted desires in this world. All the material activities in the world are being conducted under the three modes of material nature. Although these material modes of nature are emanations from the Supreme Lord Krishna, who is not subject to them. For instance, under the state laws, one may be punished, but the king, the lawmaker, is not subject to the law. Similarly, Lord is not under the influence of the laws, so he's never subject to them. That's why it's called a nirguna, which means that these three gunas or modes, although issuing from him, do not affect him. So he's very different from us. Tribhir guna mayair bhavair ebhi sarvam idam jagat mohitam nabhi janati mamebhya paramavyayam. Yeah. So everybody, tribhir guna mayair bhavair, everybody in this world are influenced by these three modes. That's what it says. Everybody in this world is influenced. Mohidam navijanati. They are, you know, mad after it. Mame bhya paramavyayam. But I am above them. Yeah, please read translation.
Deluded by three modes, goodness, passion, ignorance, the whole world does not know me. Who am above the modes and inexhaustible?
See, clearly Krishna says, when Krishna comes to this world, many people do not understand him to be God, actually. And like especially the Kauravas, right? Duryodhana would not understand Lord Krishna as God until his last breath. At the last breath, he realized, maybe this person is God. That is almost when he is dying, after the Kurukshetra war was over and he was submerged in lakes on the side on Kurukshetra, he was lying in the waters for a few days before he dies. At the time, he was contemplating all his actions and all the events. Then he realized, maybe Krishna is actually God. But that was a very late realization. So similarly, people cannot understand God when he was acting in this world. Right? The whole world doesn't know me. Mohitam navjanati. Because they were all deluded. Everybody is covered by the modes. And he is above the modes. And unless one is a pure devotee, he cannot understand. So at that time, there are only few people who understand who is Krishna. Can you guess who some of them are? some of the names you think are people who understands Krishna as the Lord? Guess any name.
Bhishma
Pitama. Yeah, Bhishma Pitama. He's the best person.
Kunti Devi.
Kunti Devi. Yeah. Kunti Devi.
Arjuna.
Oh, yeah. All the Pandavas understand that, yes.
Draupadi,
yes.
Vidura.
Perfect, thank you. Who said that?
Vidura, Rani.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Yeah, very good, yeah. So Vidura is another great personality. No, they're all great devotees.
Sanjaya.
Yeah, Sanjaya understands. Yeah, Sanjaya understands. Because he was disciple of? Who is his disciple of? Vedavyas, the author of all the Vedas. So by his grace, he even sees all the Kurukshetra war while sitting in Hastinapur with Dhritarashtra. He televises, you know, in his heart, he sees what is going on in Kurukshetra by the grace of his spiritual master, Vedavyasa. And he actually relays that information as he sees to Dhritarashtra. Yeah, so.
What about Dronacharya Prabhuji? He also knew, right?
Yeah, Drona also knows. Yeah, I'll tell you the story of Drona, right? Drona's favorite student is?
Arjuna.
Arjuna, right? He was his favorite student. But now he is fighting on behalf of Kauravas. And after Bhishma fell, so Duryodhana elected Drona to be the chief warrior from Kaurava's side. Means he's the one who directs the armies, entire army, right? So at that time, Duryodhana had one doubt. This, my teacher, he's also teacher of me. He has a soft corner for Pandavas. From beginning, I know that. Because the way he treated, you know, he knows very well. So he asked Drona, you know, in the first chapter also we hear that. This kind of cunning words of Duryodhana. He says, don't be soft corner towards Arjuna because he's your favorite disciple. Okay. Now he's in a fight for life with us. So we have to do our best. So in that way, tries to, make sure Drona gives his best. And for that, Drona laughs at him and says, "Oh, Duryodhan, I'm going to fight for you for sure, because you know it is my dharma being, Rajguru. I have to be on your side. I've eaten your salt all my life, so it is my duty to give my last breath in my service to the kingdom. So I'll fight on behalf of you, but know that." The result of the fight is in the hand of Paramatma. You and me can't decide. And the Paramatma is on the other side. What are you talking? And then, Duryodhana thinks, he's also deluded. He doesn't know who is Krishna. So, yeah, he also knows. So the bestower of destiny is on the other side. What are you, fighting against? He says, okay. It's a very beautiful verses in Mahabharata. Yeah, in this way, a lot of people know. And in fact, surprisingly, the universal form that Lord Krishna shows to Arjuna in the battlefield of Kurukshetra was shown to him in a previous instance, shown to Duryodhana in a previous instance. Anybody knows when?
When he goes to Hastinapura to convince them to not fight against the Pandavas.
Lord Krishna goes on a peace mission to actually try to see if he can avoid the fight. See, all that he's asking is that these Pandavas are Kshatriyas. They have to rule something. Give 5 villages. Duryodhana says, I wouldn't give land enough to fit the space of an eye of the needle. That's how he speaks. And in fact, he tries to arrest Krishna in the process. And Lord Krishna goes there for a peace mission. And Lord immediately expands his form and shows his Divya Swarup, the universal form. And to that, Arjuna, Duryodhana gets dismayed. Hey, man, this guy again showed his tricks. And he fears their form. And he, you know, stops any attempts to arrest Krishna. So that was the, you know, that was, so those who are demonic in mentality, even though there are so many incidents or reasons or events that are so convincing about the personality of God, they will never be convinced because their minds are deluded, and because of their selfish desires, they can't change their mind and opinions. So in this way, when Lord was there, so many people were still not understanding Lord's true nature. Yeah, the whole world doesn't know me, who I am, about the modes and the disaster. Yeah, this is a very famous verse. Daivihi esha gunamayi mama maya duratyaya mam evaye prapadhyante maya metam tarantite. Daivihi esha gunamayi. My these gunas that Lord Krishna talked about till now, sattva, rajas, and tamo guna, they are divine in nature. Daivihi esha gunamai. Maumaya duratya. They are very strong to overcome. If you are in certain modes, you cannot overcome by your own efforts. If you have certain way of seeing things, way of seeing a particular object, or a thing, or a person who is nice to you versus a person who is not nice to you. You have a certain
preconceived notion.
Yeah, preconceived notion, or you know, a way of reacting to each incident. Those are based on your modes in which you are operating currently. Very difficult to overcome. Mama maya duratyaya. Duratya means extremely difficult, impossible to overcome. Mam evaye prapadhyante. This is the secret, this is the key. Krishna is giving the key. Mam evaye prapadhyante. One who surrenders to me, maya metam tarantite. I will take away that illusion. He will overcome that illusion. It's a secret key. So, what is the secret Krishna is saying? When you are, you know, overrun by your modes, you won't react in any other way other than being influenced by the modes. The only way to get out of it is by surrendering to me. And then you will act beyond that. Okay? Please read the translation. Sagar Baba.
Yes, Prabhu. This divine energy of mind consisting of three modes of material is difficult to overcome. But those who have surrendered can easily get out of it.
Yeah. I couldn't hear clearly. This divine energy of mind, consisting of the three modes of material nature, is difficult to overcome. But those who have surrendered unto me can easily cross beyond it, can easily overcome it. Right? It's like, you know, it's the secret. So the question is, on a practical basis, how do we surrender to God? Right? That is the question. Right? So how can we take advantage of this verse? Or how do we apply this in our life so that we can benefit from it? Right? So, for example, sometimes we'll be in a depressive mood or in a very helpless situation. We all go through situations of anxiety, stress, depression, lot of unknowns, confusion, dilemmas. What do? We remember God at the time, right? Krishna Smaran. When we do that, immediately our energies are directed with Lord directly. Right? Those who have surrendered unto me can easily cross beyond it. No doubt about it. This is the secret of success. Yeah. Please further read, Prabhu.
Yes, Prabhu. The Supreme Personality of Godhead has innumerable energies, and all these energies are divine. Although the living entities are part of his energies and are therefore divine, due to contact with material energy, their original superior power is covered. Being thus covered by material energy, one cannot possibly overcome its influence. As previously stated, both the material and spiritual natures, being emanations from the Supreme Personality of Godhead, are eternal. Should I continue, Prabhu?
Yeah, enough. Yes, Prabhu. Being thus covered by material energy, one cannot possibly overcome. We are all under the influence of mode, so we cannot overcome it. We are always consistently, constantly being influenced by it. The only secret to get out of it is to remember Lord. So the easiest way, whenever you're in anxiety or stress, just keep the holy name of Lord in your mouth. Just chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Keep repeating that. You see how your consciousness diverts right away. How you start feeling somewhat calmness in your mind, and you know your thoughts will settle and you know start acting in a much mature and much balanced way. Yeah, you can see that right away. You can see that many people have experienced that. Namam Dushkritin Omudha. Now Krishna clearly talked about his position and how he is above the modes and how we are below the modes. The only way, and the modes are divine. If you want to overcome, the only way is actually to surrender unto me. Clearly says, you know, surrender unto me. Mam Evaye, only to me. Again, very clear. It's not like surrender to some unknown, you know, absolute truth or Mom means me, mama. Mom, unto me. Satyam. Prapadyante, surrender. They can overcome the energy. See, when you read these kind of verses, these are not known to us at all. These are like secrets. Those who don't study Bhagavad Gita, they literally have no idea how to manage stress. You can say so many things, you can do so many ways to inspire people, but see, the underlying human nature is very difficult to fight over. Okay, so this is the secret. So understand, what we learned is highly practical lesson that we can apply in our life. Don't take it as some simple thing. This is, I know, just knowing this could have saved so many suicides in this world. You know? So this is the secret. And the easiest way, chant the holy name. Anytime you are in trouble, distress, keep the holy name on your tongue, right? That is the teaching of all the saints of the past, right? Sant Tukaram. What does he say at the last moment of his life? Just keep your mouth vibrating the name of Vittal. And there is nothing in this world that is superior to the holy name. And that is the way to connect to Lord. It's the ekamatra upaya, he says. Right? Similarly, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Adi Shankara says the same thing. Bhajagovindam, bhajagovindam, bhajagovindam mudamate. He says, right? Why, you know, he was looking at some, you know, people trying to do jugglery of Sanskrit. Then he says, what is the value in the samsara, or, you know, what is the value in your word jugglery? Just chant the name of Govinda. Samprapte sannihita kale, nahi nahi rakshati dukkham karane. He says, so there is nothing going to protect you when your time towards death is approaching, except chanting the holy name of Govinda. Bhajagovindam, bhajagovindam. He says repeatedly in the same verse. People think that he's an impersonalist who doesn't believe in personality of God. But actually he's actually a devotee of Lord Narasimha. He's a worshipper of Lord Narasimha primarily. And he mentions this Bhajagovinda, where he says, you know, surrender to the Lord Govinda or Krishna. This is the teaching of Ramanujacharya. This is the teaching of everybody. You know, the most important lesson is very simple. Always keep the name of Lord on your tongue, and there is nothing beyond it. If you chant every day, you can see the difference. You know, your life turns around completely. And again, the quality of chanting also matters. The more you do in the morning hours, especially during Brahma Muhurta. Every day, some of the devotees actually wake up early in the morning and they start chanting at 4 a.m. You know, 4 to 6 we chant. About in our temple itself, there is a Zoom call that happens. If you are interested, you can join too. I can let the person who organizes this know. And everybody, almost like nowadays, almost 25-30 people join every single morning. And we all chant together. While chanting, you don't need to take bath or anything. Holy name doesn't have any restrictions. It's much beyond all the material aspects of your life. So just, you know, brush yourself, wash your face, and then just sit down to chant. Because that muhurta is so powerful. If you can take bath, ideal. But if you don't, also is fine. 4 to 6, we chant. And we complete all the rounds. In fact, we chant more. I chant like 24 rounds, sometimes 32 rounds. It depends. And the more I chant, the day is so different compared. The quantity defines how well the day goes spiritually for them. So this human life is a great opportunity, and the teaching is same by every saint. Chant the holy name. So don't miss this opportunity, okay? While we learn Bhagavad Gita, all this is great, but ultimately, right, 90% of our progress depends on the yoga we practice, the spiritual practices. Otherwise, this knowledge will remain theoretical for us. So take it seriously. It's a very easy method, right? So Kaler Dosha Nide Razam, Narada Muni says, in his teachings, this Kali Yoga is full of faults. Kaler dosha nidhe raza. Kaler dosha nidhe rajan astihe eko mahan guna kirtanat eva krishnasya mukta sangha param braje. This is towards the last chapter, age of deterioration. Age of deterioration means, what is the age of deterioration? Guess it.
Kali Yuga.
Kali Yuga. Yeah. Kale means Kali Yuga. Yeah. Dosha nidhe rajan, ocean of faults. Yeah, please read this. Anybody?
My dear King, although Kali Yuga is an ocean of faults, there is still one good quality about this age. Simply by chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, one can become free from material bondage and be promoted to the transcendental kingdom.
Imagine this yuga, you cannot perform deity worship, you cannot perform yagas. In the previous ages, they were perfect brahmanas. When they chant mantras, the fire would start automatically. There is no need for a matchbox. And the ghee used was pure. We don't have the pure ingredients for performing yajnas. We don't have stable mind to do sit down and meditation. No, we cannot do, you know, wonderful worship in the temples. We can do, we'll do, we are trying to do something, but we cannot do perfect of any of this. But, you know, because it's so faulty, this age is all low class, low degraded play, time. In spite of having all these faults, there is one good quality. The greatest quality of Kali Yuga is simply by chanting the holy name of Lord. It says Krishnasya, holy name of Krishna. Mukta Sangha Param Vraje. One will be liberated from material bondage. Param Vrajayat. And, you know, go to the spiritual kingdom. You can go. So, it's very important you take to chanting the Bhumi Gita. So we read this, right? Let's read the last verse. Please read this.
Whatever result was obtained in Satya Yuga by meditating on Vishnu, in Treta Yuga by performing sacrifices, and in Dwapara Yuga by serving the Lord's lotus feet, can be obtained in Kali Yuga simply by chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra.
I mean, many great saints gave different mantras, but Maha Mantra Kali Yuga is... So Hare Krishna Maha Mantra is considered Maha Mantra because it is given in Kali Santra Upanishad. There are other sampradayas, they chant, what is it? Sharanam Mama, right? Krishna, what is it? Krishna Sharanam Mama, like that, yeah. So there are various mantras. Any mantra is great, but Maha Mantra is considered the highest. Right? So, not only this. See, the Kali Yuga object space are polluted. Almighty personal hover can remove all such contamination. Contamination from the life of one who fixes the Lord within his mind. Keep the Krishna in mind. All the problems will be solved. Terrified, about to die, a man collapses on his bed. Although his voice is faltering and he is hardly conscious of what he is saying, if he utters the holy name of Lord, he can be freed from the reactions of his fruity world and he achieve the supreme destination. But still, people in the age of Kali will not worship the Supreme. I mean, this is the nature of this world. O King, in the age of Kali, people's intelligence will be diverted by atheism and they will almost never offer sacrifice to the Supreme Lord, who is the Supreme Spiritual Master of the universe. Although the great personalities who control the three worlds all bow down to the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord, the petty and miserable human beings of this age will not do so. See, this is, although the great personalities who control the three worlds, who are they? Who is he referring to?
Vishnu, Brahma and Shiva.
Yeah, like, yeah, those are there. And even the demigods, you can say, they are, you know, they control all the rain, Varuna, Vayu, right? These are all devas. Those bow down to the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord. But the petty and miserable human beings of this age will not do so. Is in a very low class way of saying, but that is the, you know, that is the description of Kali Yuga by people of the previous ages. read some more, you know, just to get a sense of what is this is. Men will no longer protect their elderly parents, their children, or their respectable wives. Thoroughly degraded, they will care only to satisfy their own bellies and genitals. Very unfortunate. In Kali Yuga, men will develop hatred for each other, even over a few coins. Giving up all friendly relationships, they will be ready to lose their own lives and kill even their own relatives. See, we are seeing that, right?
Babuji, I have a question.
Yeah.
In the previous text, you said, it said that, yeah, this one, text 43, they will almost never offer sacrifice to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, it is mentioned. So here, sacrifice means in which context they are speaking? Means sacrifice means like, yeah. So what are they indicating sacrifice meaning?
What is sacrifice? Right?
Yes, yeah.
Sacrifice means offering something which you can use for your own purpose, you offer to God, right? That is the principle of sacrifice. Principle of sacrifice means what you can enjoy for yourself, you offer to God, right? Now, what we can, so Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, what is the highest sacrifice? You know what is the highest sacrifice is? Guess it.
Is it sacrificing their own time for chanting the holy name? Or
you are absolutely right. Krishna says, I am the japa. I am the japa. Of all the yajnas, I am japa. Why he says japa? Guess it.
We have to use our mind. So, in mind, we do it.
See? 10:25. Let's read this. Maharshina Bhrigur Aham Giram Asmi Ekam Aksharam Yajnanam Japa Yajnosmi Stavaranam Himalayaha. Krishna says, you know, how you. Who I am, like he's the essence of everything, right? So now he talks about that. Please read this translation.
Yes, Prabhuji. Can I read it?
Yes.
Of the great sages, I am Bhrigu. Of vibrations, I am the transcendental of sacrifice. I am chanting of the whole names, japa. And of immovable things, I am the Himalayas.
Of sacrifices, I am the holy name. See, whatever we're practicing is the highest, best. We are not doing anything lower. You can see in so many ways, so many scriptures are talking about the same principle. I cannot stress anything more. All the scriptures are talking about the same. Japa, japa, japa. Krishna himself says, because when you are offering, when you are chanting, you are offering your consciousness to God. Because you are in your mind, you are simply thinking about the, just trying to hear the holy names of Lord, right? So chanting is the highest sacrifice. You see? People think, you know, this Ashwamedha Yajna or there are so many yajnas that people used to perform, especially in the past, in the previous ages. In Kali Yuga, nothing is effective. Why? Because we don't have pure brahmanas, we don't have paraphernalia, we don't have, any ingredients, we don't have anything. The best is the chanting of the holy name. That's what the great saint says. That's what Narada Muni is saying here, right? We described, we think we are the best. Kali Yuga, we think that we are the smartest people, right? But actually, we are the lowest, actually, unfortunately, in terms of consciousness, right? See the Brahmanas in Kali Yuga, right? This is what happens. Uncultured men will accept charity on behalf of the Lord and will earn their livelihood by making a show of austerity and wearing a mendicant's dress. Those who know nothing about religion will mount a high seat and presume to speak on religious principles. We see so many, this Baba, that Baba, Nityananda, this, that. They don't talk about Bhagavad Gita. They don't, you know, talk about the principles of life. They don't teach holy names. They claim themselves to be God, fake gurus, all fake gurus and fake gods. Nobody claims. There is no evidence in the scripture about themselves to be God, but they claim to be God. Mount high seats and presume to speak on religious principles. You see, this is happening in Kali Yuga. This is absolutely, we are seeing this. Right? Many people make, even Brahmanas, they know a few mantras. Most of them don't know the meaning themselves. They just chant. The people who invite them, they don't know any meaning. They think that some mantras are going on and we have nice fire is burnt and we paid nicely. We think, everything will be nice, auspicious. See, that is not how. The best is to invite a devotee, a nice devotee, and chant the holy name. That is the highest sacrifice, I can tell you. That will make your home auspicious, the most auspicious. In Kali Yuga, men will be rich and controlled by women. They will reject their fathers, brothers, and other relatives and friends, and will be instead associated with sisters and brothers of their wives. Thus, their conception of friendship will be based exclusively on sexual rights. This is what is happening. It says, servants will abandon master who has lost his wealth, even if that master is a saintly person of exemplary character. Masters will abandon an incapacitated servant, even if that servant has been in a family for generations. Both are bad, not just master, not just servant. Everybody is third class. Cows will be abandoned or killed when they stop giving milk. You see, this is absolutely happening, right?
Rabuji, we are just in the beginning of Kali Yuga, right?
We are in the Sandhya of Kali Yuga. It's not even, this is called golden age, the first 10,000 years. Only 5,000 years passed, and 5,000 years more is good. This is the best time, Kali Sandhya is the best period. It's as good as Satya Yuga because there is still the holy name in this time. Next 5,000 years, there is holy name. After that, Kali Yuga fully will overpower everything. But still, you see the symptoms everywhere, correct?
Correct, bro.
Businessmen will engage in petty commerce and earn their money by cheating. Even when there is no emergency, people will consider any degraded occupation quite acceptable. Even though when there is no emergency. Women will become much smaller in size and they will eat too much. Have more children than they can properly take care of and lose all shyness. They always speak harshly and will exhibit qualities of thievery, deceit, and unrestrained audacity. The brahmacharis will fail to execute their vows and become generally unclean. The householders will become beggars. Vanaprastha will, this is all, much later. Right now it's at least not as bad as this. Sannyasi, who is supposed to be giving up everything, will become greedy for wealth. Cities will be dominated by thieves. The Vedas will be contaminated with speculative interpretations of atheists. You see, people interpret. Political leaders will be virtually consume the citizens, right, by taxes. And the so-called priests and intellectuals will be devotees of their bellies and genitals. Yeah. Because of the bad qualities of age of Kali, human beings will be short-sighted, unfortunate, gluttonous, lustful, and poverty-stricken. Women becoming unchaste will freely wander from one man to the next. When there is predominance of cheating, lying, sloth, sleepiness, violence, depression, lamentation, bewilderment, fear, and poverty, that age is Kali, the age of mode of ignorance. When greed, dissatisfaction, false pride, hypocrisy, and envy become prominent along with the attraction for selfish activities, such a time is the age of Dwapar. You see, this is the time of Krishna's time. dominated by the mixed modes of passion and ignorance. This is ignorance. Our age is full of ignorance. Cheating, lying, sloth, sleepiness, violence, depression, lamentation, bewilderment. So if you do business in, you know, depression cure or something, because there is always, I think that business is going to only expand in future based on the description here, right?
Uh-huh.
Yes, Prabhuji.
Time is the age of Dwapara, right? So next is Satyuga, right? After Kali.
Yeah. After Kali Yuga, Satyuga, but the age before now is Dwapara Yuga. And the age before that is Treta Yuga. Generally, Satyuga, second should be Dwapara Yuga, third should be Treta Yuga, fourth should be Kali Yuga. That is the sequence. And these would cycle, right?
Yeah. Satya, Treta, Dwapara, Kali, right? True.
No, that is only for this cycle. This cycle is slightly reverted. Generally, it is Satya, Dwapara. Dwa means two, Dwapara. Treta, three Treta.
Okay.
Treta is the time of Lord Rama. Dwapara is the time of Lord Krishna. Kali is Kalki and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So, right? So these are the ages. But in this age, it was slightly reverted. There is a history for it. We can discuss that. Out of one full day of Brahma, out of 1,000 Chaturyugas, only one occasion where this reverts, that is this age actually. So it's a very special age.
Why is that, Prabhu? What is that?
It is primarily because, so in Kali Yuga, generally, in every Kali Yuga, the method of liberation is chanting the holy name. Okay? Generally, the person who comes at the beginning of Kali Yuga is not Krishna himself. He is an incarnation of Krishna. Okay? So he's, there is a name for it. He preaches the for the Kali Yuga, but for this yoga, Krishna himself came as Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. I mean, there is ton of evidence about in scriptures about Sri Chaitanya as the Supreme Lord himself. Because he is coming, Krishna's time was inverted so that Krishna comes and then Bhagavatam is taught, and Bhagavatam was preached in full by Lord Chaitanya this time. In full. So this is a very special age actually. Lord Chaitanya coming in Kali Yuga, the beginning of age. What no other incarnation has given is given by Lord Chaitanya. Because Krishna Prema is the highest of all the. There are devotions, various levels of devotions. For example, Lakshmi Sampradaya also performed, like Ramanujacharya, or all the South Indian Balaji temples, or you know, they have this, right? That is also devotion. That is given as, that is originally coming from Lakshmi Devi, who is, who is the closest associate of Lord, right? She started that sampradaya on how to worship, the method of worship that is given by Lakshmi Devi. That is worship in awe and reverence. But what we practice is not just awe and reverence, it is developing pure love for Lord. In our sampradaya, in Gaudiya sampradaya, that is like the mood of gopis. That is the mood of worship of all the devotees. Narada Muni says the worship of gopis is the highest because they care nothing about themselves. even for giving a little relief to. So one time, Lord Krishna gets, it's a devotional pastime. Lord Krishna has headache. And the only remedy for that is the dust of the feet of a devotee, right? And Narada Muni goes about asking for the dust from everyone. Nobody wants to give their dust. Great devotees reject. How can we give? You know, he's worshipable for us. Even to consider that itself is a sin, right? And when he goes to gopis, gopis say, we want to give. If that's what pleases Lord, we are ready to give. Because if that relieves Lord, even for a moment, for a, you know, less than a second, that is enough. Even for that sake, we are to suffer for millions of lives in hell. We are ready for it. So their love and affection for Lord is beyond any imagination or consideration. They are the purest form of devotees, the highest category of devotees. They care nothing about themselves. You know, they're always, they're fully conscious of God, fully 100%. And who are those actually? Again, those were all great rishis in their past life. They're not like, you know, just suddenly some woman who is having this sudden desire of, you know, they were actually while, you know, as when Lord came as Lord Rama, and he was in Dandakaranya with Sita, Mother Sita, and looking at the loving relationship between Mother Sita and Lord Rama, all the forest dwelling rishis, they were so mesmerized by this love between the two. And they were, you know, in their heart desiring, how can we serve the Lord in that loving mood? And Lord, in fact, benedicts them, that saying that when I come as Lord Krishna in the next incarnations, you will have the opportunity to serve me in the same mode. So those were actually the gopis. So for them, there is nothing but, you know, it's not on the material bodily platform, it's on the completely on the transcendental platform, that love is, you know, selfless sacrifice for Lord. So that is highly manifested in the life of gopis, right? So in Bhagavatam 10th canto, there is a great description of this, how much, you know, the love. In fact, they're not even attracted to Narayana. One time Lord, you know, Lord was performing this pastime with the gopis in the evening. Suddenly he disappears from their sight. And gopis were all wandering. And Lord takes the form of Lord Narayana. And suddenly gopis find Narayana. And, you know, it is not their worshipable personality. So they ask him, hey, Narayana, where is Krishna? So that is how much they love Krishna. They are never single-mindedly directed towards, you know, their love towards Lord Krishna. It's very difficult to understand at our stage of consciousness, but we'll understand, you know, as we advance more and more, right? So that can be given by Lord Krishna himself. Nobody else can give that love of God, right? And especially to the lowest people, right? Kali Yuga people. And that was available to us in this path. So that's why it's considered. He is considered Namo Mahavadanyaya. Lord Krishna came, Lord Rama came. They didn't give this kind of love. They performed the path. For example, Krishna performed this pastime. But that is, nobody can understand how to become, to get to such a position as like the gopis. How to, you know, what is the way and method? So that is given by Lord Chaitanya. To give that requires, when Lord Krishna himself doesn't come every time, right? So Lord Krishna doesn't come in every Chaturyuga. He comes once in a day of Brahma. Once in a day of Brahma means out of 1,000 ages, he comes once. And in other times, who comes? There will be other counterpart. There is another incarnation, like Lord Rama or somebody who will come. Incarnation is very different from original personality. So Lord Krishna himself comes in this. So because this is the middle age, right? We discussed about, right now we are exactly at the middle age of Brahma. So in the middle of his age, Lord Krishna himself directly comes. Brahma is just past 50 years now in his life cycle of 100 years. So at this time, Lord Krishna directly comes, the full absolute personality, and Lord Chaitanya comes right after him, and that's it. And is once in a day of Brahma, in one Chaturyuga he comes, out of thousand Chaturyugas. So that's why in this age, this is flipped. So that Krishna and Chaitanya come closer to each other. That way, the method of propagating the dharma for the age is, in a time sequence, right? If Lord, if another incarnation comes at a in say Treta Yuga, it's going to be a little distant for the past times to happen between. Yeah.
Prabhuji, you mentioned that chanting in the morning, right? So how should we join? Is it a WhatsApp group?
Yeah, it's a WhatsApp group. I'll ask the individual if anyone is interested, you can message me. I will ask the one who maintains this to actually consider you for adding to that. Try to be regular if you join. That's the main thing.
Should we stay for the whole 2 hours, 4 to 6, or can we join?
Okay, you can stay for like 45 minutes or 1 hour if you can. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, look at your, but you feel so different when you do that every day for a few days. You see, especially in the community of devotees, the way your progress, you progress spiritually is. It's going to be awesome. Yeah. Okay.
Prabhuji, as the Kali Yuga progresses, you have mentioned that the people's behavior, way of living will degrade, right? So will there be any people like who will be still inclined to pray, serve the Lord, or interested in devotional service? Or will there be absolutely no people or no devotees as the Kali Yuga progresses?
As the Kali Yuga progresses.
Yes.
Yes. So as the Kali Yuga progresses, there will be very less number of people who will be practicing spiritual life seriously. Yeah. So that was mentioned already. There will be some pure devotees. And at any time, there will be at least one or two few pure devotees. Otherwise, there is no there is no impetus for maintaining this world. Lord will always keep somebody. There will be always pure devotees. There will be people who will be fully devoted to Lord at any moment in this world's existence, because there is no other reason for the world to continue if there are people, such people are not. So, and towards the end also, there is Vishnu Yata, there is one pure Brahmana who lives till the end, right? So his son is Kalki, right? He comes after about 384,000 years from now. Oh no, sorry, 432,000 years from now. 430,000 years from now. So he will come. So that will happen.
But people say, will the world stay so long? Because people are telling that Earth will not be there.
He is not. No, those are all those people don't know. you cannot speculate anything. Those are all speculations, Madhu. The scriptures are perfect. They have served, you know. This Kali Yuga, I mean, whatever is happening is all just rinse and repeat. You know, in the previous Kali Yuga also, all these computers, all these inventions are there. Nothing new in this world. Only our imaginations are new. There is nothing in this world is new, Madhu. Everything is repetition, rinse and repeat. That's all. This is not the first Kali Yuga where all these inventions are there. All the inventions are there in the previous Kali Yuga also. There is nothing is going to end the world until next 430,000 years. And again, that ending, transition from Kali Yuga to next Satyuga is not a devastation, because it's not the end of the day of Brahma. Towards the end of the day of Brahma, there is complete devastation. Up to all the planetary systems will be destroyed. Brahma recreates the planetary system after he wakes up the next morning. But one Chaturyuga transition is a minor event, you know, among 1,000 ages. There's just one, it's like a flip, right? There will be some transition. There will be, you know, as it's mentioned, that as Kalki influences, the world would transition from Kali Yuga to Satyuga. He would eliminate all people with lower modes and begin the Satyuga, right? It's mentioned like that. So there is not going to be, even at the end of the Kali Yuga, it's not going to be like a total devastation, because it's within the day of Brahma. So nothing will happen. Things will be like this for, next 5,000 years are still great time, actually. In fact, it culminates, it just began. The holy name started spreading just 500 years ago, right? For example, Christianity, when it started 2,000 years ago, you know, for 200 years, nobody was speaking about Christianity. It's a persecuted religion. Hardly 50 to 100 people in a small village were practicing Christianity. Then, you know, some of the empires picked it up, countries picked it up. Through them, it started spreading far and wide, right? The entire continents were. For example, chanting of the holy name started only 500 years ago now, because that's the beginning of spreading of the Yuga Dharma by Lord Chaitanya. Already it is spread all over the world. It is going to spread to every village and town. That is already mentioned. In fact, this will be the method for all countries, not just, already it is there in Europe, already it is there in Africa, everywhere. Already it is there in even UAE. In a silent way, but it becomes part of every town and village. It's already predicted. We have the opportunity to spread this far and wide, because we can, so that way we can become the instruments in the hand of God, right? It's already predicted that it will happen. Whether you want to become an instrument or not is in our hand, right? Anyway, we distracted a little bit, but it was a good discussion, right? I hope you felt so.
Yes, please.
Okay, should we continue this verse? Oh, 6:30. Okay, we'll discuss this next verse. I thought of revising all the verses covered till now, because we haven't been meeting for a couple of weeks, 3 weeks. Yeah, from 15 onwards, now Krishna talks about people who don't believe in him, right? Namam drishkritano mudha prapadyante naradhama maya aparita jnana asuram bhavam asritaha. Four kinds of people who do not believe in me, he says. You meet these kind of people, don't be surprised why these guys don't believe in me. Because there will be people like Duryodhana, all the time, right? So don't expect everybody to have faith like you. And why, what is their nature, why they don't surrender is all explained here. And he also talks about the four kinds of people who surrender to him in the next verse. So we'll discuss this next, in the next week, okay? Thank you all very much for joining. Hare Krishna. Any questions?
I have a question.
Yes.
So, what is the purpose of Venkateshwar Swami's incarnation?
What is the purpose of Venkateshwar Swami's incarnation? Yeah. So, in fact, he's called Balaji. You know, Balaji literally means Balakrishna. So, he's considered Kaliyuga avatar. I mean, it's mentioned, the story is part of the Upapuran. Definitely, it is to, there will be incarnations always existing to basically help, you know, different jivas to, you know, raise in their consciousness, right? So, even this incarnation is also like that. So, all incarnations have only one purpose, whether it is explicit or implicit. It is to inspire through their stories, through their pastimes, to actually make us, you know, come closer to him. Okay? Those pastimes are like advertisements. Like, you know, in television while you watch, you get an advertisement and you feel inspired to buy that mobile by seeing that. Similarly, all these pastimes or the transcendental exchanges between devotees and the Lord, these are all wonderful, sweet pastimes to attract the hearts of conditioned souls like us, so that we become attracted, we practice devotion service and surrender our life to Him. And ultimately go back to Him. Yeah, so it is our good fortune that Lord Balaji had taken his incarnation in the hills of Tirumala. So Lord appears anywhere and everywhere, right? And he has innumerable incarnations, like we discussed in the other day. He appears in Matsya, Kurma, Varaha, Nrsinga, Vamana, Parashurama. Because he loves us so much, right? He always wants us to be turn our faces to him. So to give that opportunity to get us connected to him, he performs various pastimes. So he incarnates in various ways to reciprocate with his devotees, right? If his devotee desires, and you know, strongly, that will happen. He will come as his child, for example. Most of the incarnations happened by the appeals of the devotees. For example, Brahma appeals to Lord and then he takes the form of Krishna or Rama in the incarnates. In this way, like, every incarnation has been an influence by the prayer of a devotee. Right? For the pleasure of the devotee, Lord incarnates. Doesn't mean he comes every time, all the time, but it happens. Right?
Hare Krishna. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you for asking it. Any other questions? If not, we'll end the class here. We'll continue from verse 15 in the next week. Thank you all very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Thank you.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.